Muy buenas noches a todos. Yo soy Nelsa López, miembro de la Junta de Directores de la Fundación Biblioteca Rafael Hernández Colón y presidente del Comité de Contenido y Eventos de la Junta. Quiero darle la más expresiva bienvenida a todos ustedes, a Ponce y a esta, la sede de la Fundación Biblioteca Rafael Hernández Colón. Good evening. Esto lo voy a hacer bilingüe. I'm Nelsa López, Secretary of the Board of Directors of the Foundation Library Rafael Hernández Colón, and I want to welcome you to the Foundation Library Rafael Hernández Colón building here in Ponce, Puerto Rico. Agradecemos su presencia aquí y a través de nuestra página web a los que nos están observando en ocasión de la visita del Dr. David Rezvani, quien nos va a hablar sobre sus investigaciones, sus hallazgos y sus conclusiones expuestas en su libro titulado, y lo voy a traducir, Más allá del Estado soberano, la riqueza, gobierno propio y ventajas de seguridad de territorios parcialmente independientes. Esta es la primera actividad de un ciclo de conferencias que la Fundación estará llevando a cabo con personas ilustres que tratan temas relevantes a la situación política y económica de Puerto Rico. Luego de la participación del Dr. Rezvani, vamos a abrir la sala para que aquellos que tengan preguntas pues puedan formularle sus preguntas al Dr. Rezvani y él pueda ofrecerle sus respuestas a la misma. This is the first event in a series of conferences we will hold in which prominent speakers will discuss issues relevant to our social, political, and economic situation. Tonight, Dr. David Rezvani will present his investigations, findings, and conclusions contained in his book entitled Beyond the Sovereign State, The Wealth, Self-Rule, and Security Advantages of Partially Independent Territories. After Dr. Rezvani's presentation, we will have a question and answer period. Antes de comenzar, quisiera reconocer la presencia de algunos invitados que tenemos aquí presentes. I would like to recognize some of the people present here today. En primer lugar, Dr. David Rezvani, quien es nuestro invitado de la noche de hoy. Licenciado Rafael Hernández Colón. El señor presidente de la Junta de Directores de la Fundación Biblioteca Rafael Hernández Colón, otros directores y nuestro director ejecutivo. El señor presidente de la Pontificia Universidad Católica de Puerto Rico, el doctor Jorge I. Vélez Arrocho. Muchas gracias por estar aquí y por apoyar esta fundación. Próximamente estamos por firmar un acuerdo de colaboración entre ambas instituciones que esperamos va a hacer que propiciemos una serie de actividades muy buenas para Ponce y para Puerto Rico. Quisiera reconocer también a los senadores José Nadal Power y Ángel Rosas. Al exsecretario de Justicia, licenciado Luis Sánchez Betances. Profesores de la Pontificia Universidad Católica y estudiantes que también están aquí presentes en el día de hoy. Y todos los demás invitados a los cuales le damos nuestras más sinceras agradecimientos por el apoyo que demuestran hacia esta fundación. Para presentar a nuestro invitado, quiero pedir que suba al podio el licenciado José Alfredo Hernández Mayoral.
Buenas noches. As I warned you, David, in Latin countries, presentations are preceded by a presenter of the presenter. But I will be brief. David Rezvani es profesor en la Universidad de Dartmouth. Ha enseñado también en la Universidad de Harvard, en la Universidad de Oxford. The reason I'm doing this in English is, in Spanish, is that in case I make a mistake, you would not notice. So, en la Universidad de Oxford, en el Instituto Tecnológico de Massachusetts, en la Universidad de Boston, entre otros lugares, sus investigaciones han sido becadas por esas instituciones, así como la Fundación Smith Richardson, así como la Universidad de Hong Kong y Boston College. Difícil encontrar a alguien con ese tipo de credenciales tocando un tema como el que va él a tocar esta noche para todos nosotros. La razón por la cual se le invita a hablar aquí, lo ha dicho Nelsa, él ha escrito un libro cuya traducción es Más allá del Estado soberano, y tiene un subtítulo y trata sobre este concepto que él va a discutir de los que él llama territorios parcialmente independientes. Conociendo la discusión del estatus de Puerto Rico, nada más por saber que un libro utiliza la palabra, las palabras Estado, la palabra soberano, la palabra territorio y la palabra independiente, pues ya sabemos que debe ser algo ameno y que cada uno de ustedes tiene ahora mismo una imagen distinta de qué es lo que se debe anticipar que él va a decir. Para mí el gran valor que tiene lo que él va a hablar esta noche y lo que tiene el libro que él ha escrito para nosotros los puertorriqueños son dos cosas principalmente. Hay muchas más, pero dos cosas principalmente. En primer lugar, se trata de una persona que ha estudiado este tema sin ningún tipo de prejuicio o atadura. Eso no es común en Puerto Rico. En Puerto Rico todos tenemos una posición ya marcada sobre este tema y nuestra tendencia es a pensar y analizar el tema desde el punto de vista de la posición que ya hemos asumido. Buscamos argumentos que lo apoyan y cuando uno hace eso es difícil saber si uno está siendo objetivo o se está dejando llevar por nociones preexistentes. En el caso de él, ninguna nociones preexistentes. Él nadie le ha encargado de escribir este libro, es puramente el producto de un interés intelectual de él, llevado a cabo por su cuenta, claro, entrevistando gente y estudiando textos y distintos documentos de nuestra historia y de otros lugares, pero llegando a unas conclusiones que viene a ser lo más objetivo posible, porque no viene cargado de ninguna noción previa ni de ninguna preferencia por ninguna de los bandos en ese tipo de discusión. Lo segundo es la capacidad de ver el análisis de alguien o escuchar el análisis de alguien que no es que se sentó a examinar el caso de Puerto Rico, es que observó que a través del mundo entero se dan decenas de casos que él considera que son similares. Y explica en su libro, y supongo que explicará parcialmente hoy, por qué se crean estos territorios que él llama parcialmente independientes, cuáles son las condiciones que conducen a su formación, a su creación, y las distintas formas que estos estados parcialmente soberanos toman, dentro de los cuales él ubica a Puerto Rico. En el caso particular de Puerto Rico, pues entonces tenemos, pues, como he dicho, la visión de una persona que ha estudiado el tema con mucha profundidad, sin una noción preconcebida, y dos, con el beneficio no de estar mirando a Puerto Rico de manera aislada, sino de vernos cómo Puerto Rico se sitúa como lo que él llama un territorio parcialmente independiente dentro de esta corriente de territorios parcialmente independientes que él observa a través de todo el mundo, cómo se crearon, cómo se distribuyen los poderes, cómo se ubican dentro del país soberano más amplio que en el caso de Puerto Rico vendría siendo los Estados Unidos. En el caso particular de Puerto Rico, él hace una observación muy interesante. Él dice que los puertorriqueños, los que participan activamente en este debate se dividen en dos grupos. Los que creen que hay un pacto con los Estados Unidos, hay muchos en este salón que creen eso, y los que creen en lo que él le llama, los que creen en la supremacía de la cláusula territorial, hay algunos en este cuarto que creen eso, y en su opinión los dos están equivocados en cómo están mirando el asunto. Y aquí, pues, la clave de su pensamiento en torno a lo que sucede en el caso de Puerto Rico, y él lo explicará, yo no pretendo explicarlo completo, primero porque yo no fui el que lo escribí, segundo porque lo vienen a escuchar a él, no a mí. Pero él lo que plantea, y es algo que los puertorriqueños le tienen que dar mucho pensamiento y abrirse esa manera de pensar, y es que él ve que los que él llama los teóricos del pacto y los teóricos de la supremacía de la cláusula territorial se aferran demasiado a los textos y discuten en un plano puramente teórico, sin percatarse que hay una verdadera naturaleza de las cosas. Una constitución no escrita que va formándose a través de acuerdos informales de los líderes, declaraciones oficiales de los gobiernos, textos de decisiones judiciales que crean unas nociones y unos precedentes que constituyen esa realidad de las cosas y que nosotros discutimos el tema sin estar conscientes de ese fenómeno que está ocurriendo a su alrededor. ¿A qué lleva eso? No lo voy a adelantar yo porque sería dar las conclusiones a las que él llega en torno a cuál es la verdadera relación y las expectativas de la relación con los Estados Unidos. Para eso, pues, yo lo voy a dejar a él. Professor, as I've told the audience, well, a little bit about the audience. The audience is composed of people from all persuasions. Some of them defend statehood, and I am sure, I said some of them, but at least one of them defends statehood, and I am sure he will have questions. He probably has a record of cases before the First Circuit Court of Appeals on the issue of Puerto Rican rights to vote for the president and vote for congressmen. He has failed in all attempts, but he's known as Igartua 1, Igartua 2, Igartua 3, Igartua 4, and maybe 5. Five, we have people who believe in independence, and as you know, you have a good bunch of compact theorists. We are actually in the cathedral of compact theory. This is the epicenter of that school of thought, so beware. You should also know, and I'm sure you realize this, that territorial supremacists are themselves divided into two groups. First are those that pretend to fear that Congress might wake up one day and exercise its powers under the Territorial Clause and kick us out. And the others are those that hope that Congress actually does. Those are less. But I have informed them briefly about, I've given them a very preliminary structure of what you wrote without giving them the conclusions, because I think that is your task and that is what they wanna hear. So without any more introduction, please welcome Professor David Rezvani.
Among 177 sovereign states tracked by the Fund for Peace, about 80% suffer from varying degrees of political and economic instability. It is common to see the international system as only being composed of star-like states. What this view overlooks is the existence of partially independent territories. They include places like Hong Kong, Scotland, Iraqi Kurdistan, Puerto Rico, Northern Ireland, and nearly 50 others across the globe. Since the 19th century, partially independent territories have become significant players in international finance. They help alleviate difficult nationalistic disputes.
From the depths of my heart, I can say to you today that I believe Northern Ireland has come to a time of peace.
They provide important self-determination advantages.
What about tomorrow? It's not about whether Scotland is a nation. We are yesterday, today, and tomorrow. It's not about whether there's a Scottish Parliament. We have it after a referendum 10 years ago. It's not about whether there are increased powers. We are all agreed to increase the powers.
They illustrate part of the changing nature of international politics. The book Surpassing the Sovereign State examines the evolution of these political systems and shows how partial independence often outperforms full independence when it comes to wealth, security, and self-determination.
Thank you so much. It's such an honor and privilege to be here in Ponce and to be here in Puerto Rico. I love Puerto Rico. I should write more books so more people can invite me to things like this. All right, so so today I'll be delivering a talk on my book. I'll be presenting parts of it. I won't be presenting all aspects of my book, but I thought that I would tailor some of my presentation towards presumably the interests of some of you might ask. Typically these days when I deliver lectures for my students at Dartmouth and elsewhere, I incorporate a lot of discussion, a lot of debate into my lectures, but on this occasion I'll be delivering a straight up lecture, but certainly I guess there will be a chance for discussion towards the end. So again, I'll be discussing my book, Surpassing the Sovereign State, and in my book, I argue that partial independence tends to beat out full independence when it comes to issues such as wealth, security, and self-rule. And I point out that in addition to nearly 50 other cases throughout the world, such as Scotland, Hong Kong, and Catalonia, Puerto Rico is also an example of such partial independence. Now, today, as I speak to you, this is certainly a time in which Puerto Rico is encountering a challenging economic crisis. The territory has a debt of $72, $73 billion, an unemployment rate of 12.4%. 40% of residents receive food stamps. 45% of residents are under the U.S. poverty line. So in the midst of these challenges, perhaps some of the successes that other partially independent territories have achieved elsewhere in the world, perhaps these can serve as models of how Puerto Rico can solve some of its own challenges. So the book also discusses how partially independent territories, these are places, again, like Scotland, Hong Kong, and Puerto Rico, how they emerge, how they maintain themselves, and how sometimes they come to an end. We won't have a chance to discuss those aspects in greater detail just because of time constraints, but if you have questions about them, we can discuss them towards the end. So in my presentation today, I'll do a number of things. First of all, I'll discuss the meaning of down button. Oh, yes. There we are. So first of all, I'll discuss the meaning of partially independent territories, and I'll distinguish partially independent territories from other political forms and other units. Next, I'll talk about some of their significance from a geopolitical standpoint. And lastly, I'll talk about some of the advantages of partial independence over full independence. So when I say partially independent territory, what am I referring to? I'm referring to a territory that is, first of all, nationalistically distinct. So when I say that, I mean that it's a territory, it's a place that has a distinct population that believes it ought to rule over itself in some respects within the confines of a specific territory. I'm defining partial independence generally now. I'm not talking necessarily about Puerto Rico. The second characteristic of a partially independent territory is that it's constitutionally unincorporated. So this means that it has a distinct status and set of constitutional rules that apply to it as distinct from the core state with which it is attached, because partially independent territories are always attached to a core state. Because of this, partially independent territories are not member units of federations, which are constitutionally incorporated as an integral part of the sovereign state. And the third characteristic is that partially independent territories divide and share some sovereign powers with a core state. So in other words, they have some powers that are made very difficult to change, or they are entrenched, you could say, very difficult to change by some means. So among the powers that partially independent territories possess, they also usually have some foreign affairs capabilities, but no external defensive powers. And you can see some of the characteristics that I just mentioned in this slide. So you can see here, partially independent territories, they are allocated legal final decision-making powers, they're constitutionally incorporated. They are nationalistically distinct. They have entrenched powers. Mechanisms exist to make their powers very difficult to change. And they usually have some limited control over foreign affairs. But here are some other distinct entities, which I'll discuss right now, colonies and protectorates. The most important aspects are they aren't really legally allocated final decision-making powers, nor are their powers entrenched. And member units of federations, they do have legally allocated final decision-making powers, but they are part and parcel of the core state. So they usually get a one-size-fits-all package of powers. They can be nationalistically distinct if you consider Switzerland's federation or, let's say, Belgium's federation, but not necessarily like the United States. The mainland is, the territories are not nationalistically distinct for the most part. They have entrenched powers. But they don't have powers over foreign affairs. So you know, some people call, and this is the reason why I'm talking more about this. I think if I was giving this talk in Hong Kong, or I was giving this talk in Pakistan, like I was asked to do 2 months ago, I don't really talk about this aspect as much. But because I'm speaking to you in Puerto Rico, and this is an issue, I thought I would elaborate upon this. Some people here call Puerto Rico a colony. Some people even, it seems, want to believe that Puerto Rico is a colony. But I'm here to tell you that Puerto Rico is most certainly not a colony. And you know, this comes from me. I'm not Puerto Rican. I don't have any vested interests. I'm not a part of the, you know, pro-Commonwealth or pro-statehood party. And my job is just to study these entities. And actually, I not only study partially independent territories, I study colonies. I've submitted several papers on colonies, and believe me, there are neo-colonial forms that exist in the world. Some of them, I was just speaking with people from some of those in Pakistan. I've also lived in China, and they have some of those, like the so-called autonomous arrangement of Tibet in China. They don't have autonomy. It's just something that they say. And there are a lot of these sham partially independent territories throughout the world, but Puerto Rico is just not an example of one of those. First, like I've already alluded to, Puerto Rico is nationalistically distinct, right? Second, Puerto Rico has some constitutionally unincorporated power. So with respect to, okay, so let's say we're talking about colonies. With respect to being constitutionally unincorporated, yes, Puerto Rico also has that. Yes, Puerto Rico is national and civically distinct. But as far as entrenchment of powers, Puerto Rico has entrenched powers. It does, and I'm going to talk about that right now. And I'm actually, frankly, very surprised that when we look at some of the reports that have come out from some recent presidential commissions, I'm kind of surprised that they missed this. And perhaps we'll talk about this in more detail on some of the reasons why they missed it in a few moments. But I think a lot of this comes from a strict reading of the U.S. Constitution, which reveals that the Territorial Clause, Article 4, Section 3, Clause 2 of the U.S. Constitution, which says that all territories, and Puerto Rico is a territory, are under the plenary or absolute control of the U.S. Congress. But I argue that this view, just left alone like that, is historically, politically, and constitutionally inaccurate. And the reason I say this is that it is critical, if you're going to understand America's Constitution, it's critical, and this is what I think a lot of people miss, it's critical to understand the unwritten rules as well. All constitutions, most all constitutions, not only have written rules, they have unwritten rules as well. In terms of legal scholarship, political science scholarship, especially legal scholarship, there is a very long history, relatively long history of this in the United States. It starts at the beginning of the 20th century, where you have scholars like Herbert Horwill, who wrote a book about it. You have many scholars in modern day times who write about unwritten constitutional rules. It's not, for an expert serving on a presidential panel, you would think that they would have an understanding about that. But, to be fair, perhaps they're just not connecting the dots. Perhaps they just don't see the linkages. I'm not sure. But in any case, if you look at this slide, you can see constitutional structure. This is what you could call a country's small C constitution. These are all the government establishing and government regulating rules. It's not just about the big C constitution. That's the 1787 formally entrenched document. That's typically what people refer to as the constitution. That's the big C constitution. But that's not a country's constitution in a larger sense. The UK doesn't have a big C constitution. Israel doesn't have a big C constitution. Does that mean they don't have a constitution? They certainly have a constitution. So that's not a constitution in a larger sense. That's just their absence of a big C constitution. Every country has a small C constitution, and these are, broadly speaking, a country's government regulating and government establishing rules. And so you can see that it's divided between the written rules, the legal constitutional rules, and the conventional rules or non-legal constitutional rules or unwritten rules. It's different names for these things. They basically mean the same. And so you have jurists like Thomas Gray that have long observed that some of America's most important rules are unwritten. One of the most seminal unwritten rules is, of course, the principle that justices ought to be the ultimate arbiters of America's constitutional rules, that they can declare things constitutional or unconstitutional. If you look in the big C constitution for that power, your quest will be in vain. This comes from the small C constitutional code, what Thomas Gray calls America's unwritten rules, unwritten code. And namely, it came from Marbury versus Madison. The justices just decided that it made sense. It made sense from the standpoint of constitutional morality that the justices ought to have that power. And then after that, other justices agreed, other politicians agreed, and it became entrenched in America. And it's not just Marbury versus Madison. These legal scholars like Thomas Gray talk about every single one of America's major court cases, and it exists in other areas, are informed by these unwritten constitutional rules. And so one of the things that my book illustrates is that the powers of partially independent territories are not only entrenched or made very difficult to change through formal entrenchment mechanisms, but also in some cases through informal or unwritten or these non-legal forms of constitutional entrenchment, as in the case of Puerto Rico. So let's talk specifically about Puerto Rico now. So in many ways, like I've already said, it shouldn't really come as a surprise that Puerto Rico's post-1952 constitutional order is entrenched by unwritten rules. Why do I say that? Why should it come as no surprise? Well, the fact is that when you look at the history of the emergence of Commonwealth status, one of the main thinkers behind it was Muñoz Marín, and actually there's some others that were behind it too. People like Muñoz Marín, he drew on the status of the British dominions, and in terms of thinking about models of how the Commonwealth would be created, the architecture of it, he looked at the British dominions, the historic British dominions. But the historic British dominions are all about that. If the constitutional rules are like oceans, and one of the oceans is unwritten constitutional rules. With the British dominions, it's like you're swimming in unwritten constitutional rules. There's no way you can get around it with those, especially in the British system. So one of my chapters in my book is about these British territories. And one of the fascinating things about these political systems is that in terms of legal rules, these were all blatant examples of colonies. So on paper, they're colonies, the British dominions. On paper, the British appointed governor generals were in some ways like autocratic rulers who could do whatever they wanted in those territories. The unwritten rules, however, told a completely different story. So beginning with Canada, and later including places like Australia, South Africa, Ireland, and others, after 1846, the UK and Dominion leaders informally agreed to bring into being a new constitutional order for these territories. Just as unwritten rules prevent the British Queen from exercising her vast legal powers that still exist today, to control the military, to control the parliament, it was agreed that the role of the Governor General would also mostly become symbolic. So on paper, the governor generals had all of these crazy supreme powers, but in accordance with the political agreements between British leaders and Dominion leaders, the role of the governor general informally, not legally, but through unwritten constitutional rules, through these imperial conferences, in accordance with the agreement between leaders, the governor general's role would become mostly symbolic. And they agreed that the division of power would be such that that the UK would mostly handle foreign and defense issues and some limited domestic issues, whereas the Dominions would mostly control their own internal affairs. And so over time, what happened was that there became a deep reluctance of interfering arbitrarily in these territories, and it emerged with respect to these territories. Precedents of non-interference also continued to solidify over time. And so instead of statutes, directives, common law, or the Big C Constitution establishing the new order for these territories, it was done instead by informal agreements, precedent, and generally accepted principle. And so you can see that here. Over here, you have the typical components of small c constitutional structure, like the framework statute. So for example, if you look at key institutions in America, they're not in the Big C Constitution. The CIA, the Pentagon, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, all those came from the 1947 National Security Act. That's a framework statute, Directives like, for example, President Kennedy's creation of the Peace Corps. Again, another government establishing rule, common law from justices. And then, of course, you have the formally entrenched Big C constitutional structure. But as far as the British dominions are concerned, none of these things created their partially independent status. They're widely acknowledged and understood partially. I mean, it's not controversial with them. Pretty much everyone understands that they have partially independent status. But with them, instead, you have these informal agreements through these imperial conferences. You have these precedents over time that continue to solidify every year that went by that the British government did not arbitrarily exercise its written powers, it solidified. And you have the generally accepted reluctance of arbitrarily intervening in their affairs. And so instead of being judicially enforced, although justices have acknowledged, informally acknowledged, the operation of these unwritten rules, instead they tend to be enforced through political mores, through political inertia, because other people do it, you do it. And through political difficulty and benefit over time. For example, members in America's Congress, frequently they're coming up with these informal rules, and they're not something that could be legally enforced. For example, one of them might say, if I pass this law that favors your interests, you will pass another law that favors mine. If they don't abide by that, there might be political difficulty for them, but it's not something that's judicially enforceable. So these unwritten constitutional rules are quite common in many political systems, especially the US and the UK. Likewise, in Puerto Rico, after 1952, similar conditions prevail. Congress's plenary power is indeed legally intact, similar to the British powers that are legally intact. But nevertheless, it's nullified and rendered inoperable by unwritten rules. In place of the nullified territorial clause is the rule that the central government ought not to usurp Puerto Rico's 1952 arrangement without its permission. And similar to the constitutional relationship between the British dominions and the British government, the legal documents, such as the territorial clause, say one thing, but the informal agreements, principles, and increasingly over the course of time, precedents of non-interference convey a very different constitutional picture. So as far as informal agreements are concerned, these informal agreements, for example, there you have the exchange of letters between Munoz Marin and Harry Truman at the outset of the Commonwealth status in 1952 or in and around that time, which underscored that powers cannot be changed except by mutual agreement. You also have deeply held principle that Puerto Rico's powers cannot be arbitrarily taken away, which has been articulated by a number of federal courts, including non-legally binding dicta statements by the Supreme Court, when in 1982, they said, quote, Puerto Rico, like a state, is an autonomous political entity sovereign over matters not ruled by the Constitution, unquote. So that was a dicta statement. It's non-legally binding, but that is what the Supreme Court says, articulating this generally accepted principle. Puerto Rico's ability to push America's military out of Vieques in 2003 after its testing on the island further underscored the rule that America ought not interfere in Puerto Rico except through mutual agreement. And what's more is leaders of both parties also seem to agree that Puerto Rico is protected in such ways. For example, at a recent congressional hearing in June 2015, the idea was raised that perhaps Puerto Rico's government could be taken over by a congressional control board in response to the recent crisis. So Puerto Rico has a crisis. Some members of Congress say, I have a nice idea. Why not just take Puerto Rico's government over? Why not do that? And in response to this, Puerto Rico's resident commissioner, Pedro Pierluisi, he defended Puerto Rico. He defended Puerto Rico and he said this. He said, "We have a Republican form of government blessed by this Congress. And so unless you suspend the effectiveness of our Constitution, which makes no sense, you don't appoint a financial control board to take over Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico, with all due respect to the District of Columbia, is not the District of Columbia. It is not the city of New York. There is case law from the Supreme Court saying that we deserve deference in terms of our own self-government for local affairs." And one thing I really liked about him as he said this, as he was making this statement, one of the congressmen was interrupting him. But at that time, Pedro Pierluisi, he was on the dais with other members of Congress. He wasn't a supplicant down below. And he just continued to talk and press that point. And so, as I say in my book, if tomorrow Congress unilaterally and arbitrarily used its legal powers under the Territorial Clause to abolish Puerto Rico's powers, to place its governor under arrest, and to declare a permanent state of martial law in Puerto Rico, it would, as I argue, be entirely within its legal authority to do so. Legally, it could do all those things. Legally, it could do all those things. But presumably, if that did happen, countervailing political actors or courts would intervene to prevent such usurpations. But just for the sake of argument, let's just say that those things happened. If such actions were successful, they would be just as absurd as the British Queen exercising her legally existent capability of controlling the military, abolishing the parliament, and dismissing the British Prime Minister. Similarly, it would be just as absurd, if not more so, for the US President to use his legally existent power as the Commander-in-Chief to violently bully Congress, like Boris Yeltsin did, send the tanks, send it around the Russian Duma to badger members of the Russian parliament. That would be equally absurd in America's context. So the bottom line is that while Congress's exercise of its legal plenary power over Puerto Rico would not violate America's Big C Constitution, sending the tanks around the White around Congress doesn't violate the Big C Constitution, and declaring martial law in Puerto Rico or arresting the Governor General or the Governor doesn't violate the Big C Constitution, but it most certainly violates the Small C Constitution, because Small C Constitution includes unwritten constitutional rules. So I'm happy to answer any questions on that that you might have, but I want to turn now to the significance of partially independent territories. So partially independent territories have become significant factors in international affairs in the areas of global finance, international security, and geostrategic capability. And you have some pretty sophisticated offshore financial centers in the world that are partially independent territories, PITs, which I call them, PITs, partially independent territories like the Cayman Islands, Hong Kong, and Liechtenstein are some of the most sophisticated offshore financial centers in the world. Partially independent territories receive about $3.5 trillion of the world's cross-border loans. And I didn't say billion, I said trillion. $1 trillion, and this amounts to about 15% of all global lending. According to data from the Bank of International Settlements, partially independent territories receive about 76% of all loans that go to the world's offshore financial centers. You can see that here. Partially independent arrangements like those for Northern Ireland and for the Kurdish territories vis-a-vis Iraq also serve as centerpieces of compromise for some of the world's most difficult nationalistic disputes. And partially independent territories like Greenland and New Caledonia, vis-a-vis France, also furnish military basing rights, an extended maritime economic zone, and preferential natural resources to sovereign states that they're associated with. Capabilities and assets that were primary reasons for forcible imperial control in the past, because in the past, states were looking for things like this. They were looking for extended military basing rights. They were looking for an extended maritime economic zone. They were looking for preferential access to natural resources. All these can be made available to core states, sovereign states, with a mutually agreeable arrangement. So why should we expect partially independent territories to surpass the sovereign state, like I've said? We should expect this type of relative success for three reasons. First of all, these partially independent territories benefit from a wide array of public goods that are furnished by a typically powerful core state. The quantity and quality of such services from another state, in most cases, is not available to fully independent states in the international system. They just don't have the same degree of advantages. This includes defense, it includes customs unions, it includes fiscal transfers from the core state to the partially independent territory, it includes single market access, it includes expert advice, shared reputational association. It also includes things like proxy diplomatic representation. Such public goods allow local vested interests, specialization, accountability, and competition that the centralized rule of a sovereign state oftentimes cannot provide. It's arguably no accident that partially independent territories have an average GDP per capita of about $33,144, which is nearly four times higher than those of sovereign states. Sovereign states have a GDP per capita of around $10,000, roughly $9,780. And even when you do an apples-to-apples comparison, as I've done, as I do in my book, when you control for things like geographic region, or someone could say, if I look at the average GDP per capita of states and compare them to the average GDP per capita of sovereign states, of partially independent territories, it may well be some people might say that perhaps something else is driving that difference, not necessarily the fact that these are partially independent territories. So what you want to do to get away from that is you want to find very similar cases of sovereign states and compare them to very similar cases of partially independent territories. And I do that in a number of ways in my book, statistically and through a variety of other means that I won't get into now. If you have questions on that, I'm happy to answer them. But the bottom line is that even when you do an apples-to-apples comparison, partially independent territories are still way ahead of sovereign states economically and in terms of their security. A second reason, apart from the public goods that I just mentioned, second reason why partially independent territories are better than sovereign states, have advantages over sovereign states, is that partially independent unions tend to do more to satisfy the distinct nationalism of core and territorial populations than the alternative of sovereign statehood. PITs satisfy core state nationalism by allowing them benefits, such as some of the benefits I've already mentioned, that core states receive preferential access to minerals, distant military basing rights, an expanded economic zone, without the inconvenience of imperialism. In addition to the distinctive public goods that are available to them, PITs better satisfy territorial interests by allowing powers of guaranteed self-determination that are usually not available to fully independent states. So if you become fully independent, You're on your own. You're in the anarchy of the international system. I'm not saying you, Puerto Rico. I'm saying generally, if some group of people decided to become fully independent, they would be on their own. They would be in the anarchy of the international system. And you know, oftentimes there's no guarantees for anything. Typically, you don't these days have sovereign states going around attacking other sovereign states. But what is a very common feature of newly independent sovereign states is internal coups and rebellions, and you don't have any guarantees to prevent that. But in a partially independent arrangement, this actually exists. There are those guarantees. There's the entrenchment that I talked about, the guarantees of the powers that have been allocated. And so, for example, in the case of Scotland, when you had internal strife between the two groups, ultimately the British came through and with their guarantees, and they clarified their willingness to entrench the arrangement. Another advantage of partially independent arrangements is that they are more secure. As compared to sovereign states, partially independent unions tend to have improved security because they are the embodiments of compromise between core and territorial societies. Disputes that may have otherwise been settled with street violence or on the battlefield are authoritatively resolved in the sober chambers of a parliament, courtroom, or through political negotiations. So in sum, paraphrasing a political scientist, if you are interested in survival amidst the dangers and challenges of the international system, the best way to survive is not necessarily to have your own state and lots of power. As former U.S. President Bill Clinton said in a different context, "We're in this together" is a better philosophy than "you're on your own." And so in concluding, I think I would first point out that partially independent territories are not a panacea for all problems. In spite of the emphasis here on their advantages, partially independent territories are certainly not the ultimate solution for all problems of poverty, insecurity, and nationalism faced by the world's population. But I would say that there are three ways that the study is relevant for Puerto Rico. First of all, it shows that Puerto Rico is arguably not a colony because of the existence of unwritten constitutional rules. Secondly, it shows that Puerto Rico is not alone in the world and that there are, in fact, many other cases of partial independence similar to Puerto Rico. I think I have a map here somewhere. Yes. Probably can't read this very well, but these are the other partially independent territories throughout the world. And thirdly, it hopefully provides some hope for Puerto Rico in the midst of the current crisis. These partially independent territories tend to be very wealthy, stable, and secure, and there are many models to draw upon. It's my view that Puerto Rico is I was telling someone earlier today, it's as if, you know, when you compare Puerto Rico to some of the other surrounding sovereign states in the Caribbean, like the Dominican Republic or Cuba, and there are, you know, a good number of other comparable sovereign states to Puerto Rico, in some respects Jamaica, Puerto Rico is way ahead of them. Puerto Rico has a GDP per capita that is about four times the average of sovereign states in the Caribbean and five times the average of other sovereign states in South America. So Puerto Rico is way ahead. But it's as if Puerto Rico when you compare it to, I'm a runner. I actually ran this morning. I went for a jog, 3 mile jog in the morning. But I'm an amateur. I'm nothing compared to someone who's on, let's say, an Olympic team. I'm not an Olympic runner. But Puerto Rico is like an Olympic runner. But when you look at the Olympic team, if you look at these other partially independent territories, It's unbelievable their level of success. How many of you know the GDP per capita of Bermuda? It's not, okay, so the GDP per capita of Puerto Rico is roughly around 20,000 or so, give or take. The GDP per capita of the US is 40,000. The GDP per capita of Bermuda and some of these other partially independent territories in Puerto Rico's neighborhood, these guys here, GDP per capita of Bermuda is not, America's is 40,000. It's not 50,000 in Bermuda. It's not 60. It's not 70. It's not 80. It's not 90. It's 100,000 per capita. 100,000. And it doesn't come from tourism. It comes from the fact that they have, over time, specialized in international finance, as have some of these other ones, like the Cayman Islands and others. So Puerto Rico has a lot of potential, and I feel like they might not be a star on the Olympic team, but they're on the Olympic team, potentially with a few adjustments. It's probably not going to be easy, but with a few adjustments, potentially Puerto Rico could potentially have a much brighter future than it has already achieved. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rezvani. And now we can open a question and answer period for anyone who is interested in expounding upon some of the concepts that were presented here by Dr. Rezvani. Si alguien tiene alguna pregunta, el Dr. Rezvani está disponible para ofrecerle sus respuestas.
In your book, you make you list the American tribes or the American nations, the Indian nations in the U.S. as a sham, partially independent territory. Can you draw the distinction between them and Puerto Rico? Why is one case different from the other?
Okay, yeah, that's very interesting. Another thing that I study are sham autonomous arrangements, sham partially independent territories, and there's quite a number of those in the world. I might have mentioned a few already, like the Bantustans of South Africa. Actually, I haven't found any evidence of this. I'm looking for it, and I tend to think that I eventually will find it, but I wouldn't be surprised at all if the apartheid government of South Africa looked at America's practice towards the Native Americans and modeled their Bantustans, these terrible arrangements that they created in their sinister design to pack all the people, all the indigenous people onto these Bantustan territories and say, these territories have self-government. They have self-government. And proudly saying they have self-government. And when people complained about the conditions in those territories, they said, well, these people govern themselves now. But they actually didn't govern themselves. Most of all the powers were actually in the apartheid government's hands. And really, the Native American arrangements were very similar to this, in especially the late 18th and 19th centuries. You had justices like George Marshall, John Marshall in the Marshall Court in Cherokee versus Georgia, who clearly stated that the Native Americans have a kind of sovereignty, but it was all just a sham. It was a sham form of autonomous arrangement. And it exists today to a large degree. You have books written by people such as jurist Alexander Alienikoff, who talk about how even up until recent times, in the 1980s, 90s, and recent times, courts are frequently sticking their hands into the affairs of Native Americans. And And so, if you want to look for a case of an American neo-colonial arrangement, it's not difficult to find. They're all over the place, especially with the Native Americans. But, you know, you just don't see that type of behavior at all with Puerto Rico after 1952. There are really no cases that I know of. When I was here last time in Puerto Rico, I met with some of the independence leaders in the Capitol building, and I asked them, so if Puerto Rico is a colony, so where is the interference? When is America stealing the powers from Puerto Rico? And they mentioned a few. They mentioned a few cases, and I go over them in my book and another article I wrote. And there's just really easily dismissible, fairly easily dismissible cases. So far from that, you see precedents over time, over time of non-interference. So, yeah, I think it's important to see this distinction between partial and sham arrangements. Other questions?
I sense from your book, and I could be wrong, a predilection or that you like unwritten rules. And I'm going to go back a little bit. There's a point, as we all know, in all legal systems, and let's talk about the international legal system, where there's little written law and everything is customary law and precedent and unwritten convention. But that type of legal world lends itself to a bit of confusion once in a while. For one country, one thing could be a diplomatic committee practice, and for another, a customary norm. And then it becomes a controversy. For that reason, I think, you have this international law is now predisposed towards treaty arrangement and written norms, and so you don't have confusion. So would you say that written norms are better than unwritten norms in the sense of clearly establishing contracts or obligations? And a separate question, completely separate question. I want you to speak on whether, in your definition of partial independence, the spectrum of partially independent states or territories, U.S. type free association is within, like Palau, and I think they are. And I want you to comment, if you can, also on world experiences on nationalistically different, fully federative arrangements like Switzerland. Why don't they happen more?
Why don't
Switzerland type arrangements happen more? I think the answer is that a central government doesn't want to give a different nation powers usually.
Do you mean why don't federations happen more?
Why don't nationalistically distinct federations happen more, like Belgium or Switzerland? Mm-hmm.
Okay, some great questions there. Right. As far as the first question, are written or unwritten constitutional rules better? You know, in the British context, it was very difficult for the British to change their laws for whatever reason. And actually, one of the British prime ministers talks about this, and he says that the reason why they created these unwritten rules is because it allowed a certain flexibility whereby political leaders could move forward with allocating a certain status to these territories without the intense controversy that sometimes is generated by actually formally amending the rules and allocating legal powers. And that was the British context. In the Puerto Rican context, I suppose you could say some of the same. I mean, the fact is that In my humble view, some of you might disagree, but I think the effort, putting a lot of effort to get America to formally entrench Puerto Rico status, I don't know if I want to say that it's a waste of time, but I mean, Puerto Rico, in my view, already has entrenchment. It's already a partially independent arrangement. It's like you're 16 years old and your dad doesn't say that you could drive the car, but puts the keys on the counter and does everything to make it possible for you to drive the car. I mean, I suppose that's a really bad example because you'd still want your father's formal permission. I'm thinking about my own son. Perhaps it's a case where every day you received permission, let's say, from your father on 6 days of the week. The seventh day comes about and your father does everything the same. He puts the keys on the table. He does everything the same to hint that you can drive. And so you think you can drive the car, and you can drive the car because he doesn't mind. Precedents and other things have shown you over time that, I mean, it's an imperfect analogy. But the point is that Puerto Rico is in no danger of losing its status. If you just look at the precedents over time, and especially if you look at Vieques, Vieques is a case in point. Sometimes I tell my students that if I tell you I have an invisible shield around me, right? You will say, of course, he doesn't have an invisible shield, right? But I would want you to be able to test that invisible shield. Now, in reality, I don't have an invisible shield around me, of course. But if I did tell you that, I would probably say, well, test it. Throw something at me. And let's say you threw it and it bounced off. And you say, oh, he has an invisible shield. And it's the same way with Vieques. In the case of Vieques, you had very powerful members of Congress that wanted to keep their bombing and pollution of Vieques. And the Puerto Ricans were able to actually press back America. How did it do such a thing? It's really remarkable. And it wasn't just through political power alone. If you look at the congressional hearings on Vieques, as I have, you can see from the statements of members of Congress that there is this type of deeply held principle that they ought not to take powers away. So I would say that putting a great deal of effort into making the formalized entrenchment Puerto Rico right now is in the middle of a crisis, and you probably want to use your resources in better ways than that. As far as U.S. free association, so there are some territories out there like the Federated States of Micronesia or Palau or the Marshall Islands. These are all freely associated territories. I refer to these as partially independent territories with a wide set of powers. So I also include them as partially independent territories. Partially independent territories aren't the same in the world. They're all very different in terms of their allocations of powers and the ways that they divide and share powers with the core state. And actually, that is the virtue of partially independent territories. I'm happy that they're not all the same. And the reason why I'm happy that they're not all the same is because they tend to be, in many cases, tailor-made arrangements, tailor-made for the specific issues that are going on in that area, tailor-made for the problems that are happening there and the needs of the local population. That's why it's so upsetting when Puerto Rico seems to have all these unique needs that are distinct from the mainland that they can't get the cooperation right now they need from the U.S. government. But the potential is there. The potential's not there for Florida. The potential's not there for Texas. But the potential's there for other territories. But yeah, the bottom line is that I see free association as also part of the same type of, in the same taxonomical category. As far as your question of why don't Swiss federations happen more, I'm glad you raised that issue. If I were to give advice to the pro-statehood party, What advice would I give them? I suppose I would advise them to move in the direction of some type of asymmetrical union with the United States, so they could keep their statehood ideas, becoming a member unit of America's Federation, but still have an arrangement that's more akin perhaps to the autonomias of Spain. I look at them as kind of a hybrid between partial independence and having a federation member unit status, because they still have representation in Spain's parliament, but they have their own distinctive package of powers. And in that way, they could keep their aspirations on that while also tailor-making some of the rules towards Puerto Rico's interests. You know, I think that's one of the main challenges that Puerto Rico faces today. Puerto Rico is distinct from other parts of the United States. It's, you know, obviously it's an island. Most other states in the Union, you know, of course you have Hawaii and to some degree Alaska, but most other states of the Union don't have some of the same island geographically oriented challenges that Puerto Rico has, like the problems that occur. Now, I'm happy to talk about this more, but like the Jones Act, that doesn't affect, that helps. The Jones Act helps Texas and Florida and Massachusetts, but hurts Puerto Rico almost exclusively. I suppose it hurts Hawaii, it hurts Alaska, but so that's one thing to think about. Puerto Rico has distinct economic needs. You know, the population has a GDP per capita that's lower, that's significantly lower than the rest of America. So applying the same federal minimum wage also doesn't make sense. So a lot of examples like this, where arguably Puerto Rico is like, you know, let's say you're, I've taken some of my children. I remember my son, one time some can hit my son on the head and we had to take him to the emergency room. And I remember there's a lot of people in the emergency room lined up. And I had this feeling as a father, you know, what's wrong with these people? Why don't they help my son? You know, I was in the emergency room. I want immediate assistance. So I suppose a knee-jerk reaction as a father would not be to say that, you know, my son just had a cut right here from this can that fell on him, but to say that my son is going to die. My son has cancer. My son is, you know, some invent some diagnosis that doesn't exist. And then maybe the hospital staff would be more likely to help my son. Similarly, you could say, Puerto Rico is a colony. Puerto Rico is, you know, a disaster, and therefore you need to help Puerto Rico. But the problem with that is that by misdiagnosing, as the physician, by misdiagnosing the problem and treating Puerto Rico as something that it just isn't, it might move people in the wrong direction. So that's a long answer to three different questions.
I have a follow-up on that.
Yeah?
When you say if you were to give this state of the party some advice, and I thought you were going to say to forget about it, but just wishful thinking on my part. But you suggest something like Catalonia, but is that arrangement possible within the U.S.? Big C that will come into play there. I mean, what they strive for is participation. I mean, what they call equality, which means being having two senators in a Senate of 102 and having five representatives in a House of 435 or 440. They call that equality. I don't see that as equality. I don't know how, you know, I'm not equal to California that has, what, 50 congressmen, whatever. But I don't see that type of an arrangement at all possible within the U.S. Constitutional framework. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I mean, not being a state, but having congressional voting participation.
Yeah.
Very hard.
The reason why I say that is because, you know, I mentioned some of these other needs that arguably Puerto Rico has with respect to making a tailor-made arrangement. But I don't see those as Puerto Rico's number one challenge. I don't see them as Puerto Rico's number one problem. In my humble view, the number one problem that has plagued Puerto Rico, that has been a curse for Puerto Rico, is the political war of attrition between the pro-statehood party and the pro-Commonwealth party. And it is really hurt badly Puerto Rico. It makes it so that Puerto Rico is just a regular guy on the Olympic team of partially independent territories, not the Cayman Islands, not having, you know, 100,000 per capita GDP. So when I suggest that for the statehood party, I'm making that suggestion because I'm just trying to think of a way, some way. I mean, presumably statehood party people won't buy my suggestion anyway, but some way where the Commonwealth, pro-Commonwealth party and pro-statehood party could find more areas to agree. If let's say for whatever reason the pro-statehood party adopted that, at least they would be on the pathway towards choosing policies that are tailor-made for Puerto Rico, rather than looking at the one-size-fits-all arrangement for that applies to a state of the union. You know, the law, as I already mentioned, the laws that are made for the states of the union, these were formulated in the 18th century. These are 18th century division of power. Later on, they were adjusted over time with various laws and various rules and various amendments. But they are a one-size-fits-all package that just doesn't apply to Puerto Rico in so many ways. So I was thinking of ways of bridging the gap. Another way of bridging the gap, potentially, and I was talking about this with some friends recently, was potentially to change some of Puerto Rico's electoral laws, because the electoral laws tend to push with a majoritarian system, as Puerto Rico mostly has. It tends to create two parties. This is known as De Bourget's law. He's a French political scientist. But if Puerto Rico had a proportional representation electoral system, which tends to yield many parties, like with Israel's, I don't know how many they have. It's like 15, 20 parties. France has 20 parties. They're also proportional representation. Belgium, Switzerland, all of them have proportional representations electoral systems. This would then generate new parties that presumably aren't in this war of attrition on statehood. Another thing on this is that I saw this June 2015 congressional hearing, and I was disappointed in some of what I heard from some of the representatives of Puerto Rico. You know, Puerto Rico, even though I have described Puerto Rico as being more advanced than other fully independent states elsewhere in the world, still, Puerto Rico is going, let's admit the fact, Puerto Rico is, relative to where it could be, is going through an economic crisis. So what you would hope at a congressional hearing is, in June of 2015, you would hope that the Puerto Rican leaders are talking about ways where you can get out of the crisis, right? It's a crisis. But they're not talking about that. They're talking about status issues. They're talking about how Puerto Rico is a colony. It's just, you know, I just don't see it as being so helpful. Truth be told, not all of them were talking about that, but some of them were. And I thought, you know, it's better to talk about other things. It's as if your ship is sinking, you know, and you're talking about buying a new boat. You don't want to talk about buying a new boat. You want to talk about the boat you already have, and the water is rushing in. How are you going to plug the holes? So, anyway.
Sure, okay. a couple of things. First of all, about the entrenchment. The pro-Commonwealth people realize that we are already entrenched. We are not seeking entrenchment. We are seeking some changes in the present rules to make a better perfect union. But the basic entrenchment for us is already there. It's the Commonwealth. I wanted to clear that up. Then, secondly, on the behavior of Congress regarding Puerto Rico, at the beginning of the 20th century, when the United States came in, they tried to make Puerto Rico a bilingual country. And therefore, the language of instruction in Puerto Rico was English. And that was so through all the American governors until we had Muñoz Marín. And Muñoz Marín came in and he established Spanish as the language of instruction. No questions were raised in the Congress, and no problem arose because of that. Then another thing that the people of Puerto Rico don't know about, but I say it here for the first time because nobody asked me. During my last administration, we established Spanish as the official language of Puerto Rico. Since the US governors, it had been both languages. We established Spanish as the first official language of Puerto Rico. Not that we were not going to teach English, and not that our people to learn English. It wasn't that. It was to affirm what was our own language. I, as governor of Puerto Rico, didn't have one single protest from any functionary or any congressman or any senators or anybody in the United States government. That's the way that they behave when you assert yourselves and you do things that are within your sphere of autonomy. Now, the last thing is a question about the big C and the small C. The territorial clause is in the Constitution with the big C. And when you look at it right now, it's there, and it gives plenary powers to the Congress of the United States in the Constitution, in the big C Constitution. Now, when those plenary powers are exercised and a new situation is created, what happens? In the case of 37 actual states, territories became states of the Union. They came by law of Congress. The Philippines, through a law of Congress, that territorial power was exercised and an independent country came about. And so with Puerto Rico, it was also exercised and we became a Commonwealth. Now, the respect that's owing those three entities, is it a big C or is it a small C? And if it's a small C, well, If I go into what I was going to go into, I would go into the realm of absurdity. And I don't think I want to do that. But just the three questions.
Right. I'm not sure what the first two questions are. I think I understand the third one.
All right. No. The states. Is it big C or small C? Philippines, big C or small C?
Mm-hmm.
Puerto Rico, big C or small C?
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Yes. Okay. Very good. I would say that as far as the entrenchment of Puerto Rico, the protections that prevent Puerto Rico's powers from being usurped, I would say that they are all within the small C aspect that trumps what happens in the big C. Occasionally, you have powers that might be exercised. You know, it doesn't mean two things. It doesn't mean that the power can never be exercised. It doesn't mean that, you know, tomorrow, like I said, the United States may well do some crazy act, but then you would have other things to weigh against that. Occasionally, unwritten constitutional rules do change, and in some cases, they go away completely. So for example, you have, we were talking about one crazy idea of the President of the United States deporting members of Congress, let's say. You know, taking members of Congress that they don't like, maybe Obama's upset about some Congress members, putting them on a Black Hawk helicopter and taking them across the ocean to some weird spot, dropping them off at some island, deporting them. It might seem like maybe you're thinking I've watched too many sci-fi films to make that suggestion. But the reality is that there was one president that actually did that, not with a Black Hawk helicopter, but President Lincoln deported members of Congress. So it does happen, but then you have to decide what you're gonna do. There's two options then. There's what international legal scholars call a non-liquit, which means that the entire rule that previously existed, that the president ought not to use his powers as commander-in-chief for tyrannical reasons, a non-liquit means that there's no more rule, and the game is over, and now the president is a dictator. That's one possibility, but the possibility that actually turned out is that the rule retained itself, and the exception came that the president can use the rule in these exceptional circumstances. So with respect to, let's say, the Philippines or Puerto Rico, there are exceptional circumstances where the territorial clause could be exercised, like in the arrangements that you mentioned. But in other areas, they are not.
Well, do you think it could be exercised regarding the Philippines?
The United States did indeed exercise its power to allow independence for the Philippines.
Yeah, what I mean is after independence was granted.
And then go back and say,
and then
no,
go back
change your mind.
And say, well, we're not going to exercise again
territorial
power.
Absolutely not.
I mean, there's a factual situation created. Mm-hmm. There is an independent nation out there.
Yeah.
And you have the 37 states. Mm-hmm. They're in there. They've been created.
Mm-hmm.
There were territories, except a couple of them. And can you go back?
Mm-hmm.
So the same path was followed regarding Puerto Rico.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
An enabling act permitted us
mm-hmm.
to draw up our own constitution.
Mm-hmm.
And gave us the right to vote.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I would say that in the case of the states that became, that were the territories that became states of the Union, as far as the question of how they are entrenched now, I would say it's probably a mixture of both formal entrenchment and unwritten rules. Mm-hmm. But with Puerto Rico, there's not the formal entrenchment part. There's just the unwritten part.
Except the compact.
Except the compact, right. Well, yeah.
Good evening, sir, and congratulations for your book, for your investigation. Your presentation has been a great experience for us. I'm part of a group of students from the Pontifical Catholic University here in Ponce. We are doing our master's degree in history. So the professor told us to come here. It has been great. I have a question of mine and some small, short questions from the students. I don't know if you prefer that I give you right. I will make my question first. Yeah. I will read it. It's better for me to read it. Under the actual status of Puerto Rico, Puerto Rico has some fundamental limitations to step out of the economic crisis that we have. For example, we are under this, I don't remember the English name, the La Ley de Cabotaje, the Cabotage Law.
Jones Act.
Yeah. And a recent study of the General Accounting Office declared the negative effects for our economy of those laws. We cannot create protectionist taxes for our internal production against the invasion of foreign imported products. And recently we have discovered that the bankruptcy laws for state do not apply to Puerto Rico, at least not yet. Even a federal court recently declared that the internal bankruptcy law that the actual government created was not permitted. With all these limitations and using the terms that you use of partially independent country, can we affirm, maybe it's a thing of names, but can we affirm that Puerto Rico can be also defined as a partially colonized country if it's partially independent? How can we name the other part of that partial definition, right? That would be the question. Mm-hmm. Right. How can we name that other part? It's partial independent. What about the other part? How can we call it?
Okay. Interesting question. So all partially independent territories have a division of power, all of them. And in this division of power, some powers are in the hands of the core state. And some other powers are in the hands of the partially independent territory. Now, as far as the powers that are in the hands of the core state, they control that power. Call it what you will, but it is their power to control. One analogy to think about, I'm full of analogies, you could say that the philosopher John Locke, he talked about individuals who are in the state of nature, right? State of nature, like a hunter-gatherer, like a caveman, right? Caveman is in the state of nature, he has his animal skin, he's not in society, he's not in civilization, he has to survive on his own. And the hunter-gatherer, he's on his own. So John Locke, he asked, why is it that this hunter-gatherer, why would this hunter-gatherer give up his sovereignty in the state of nature? Why would he do such a thing? Why would he put so much of the powers that he otherwise exercises in the hands of someone else? Why would he do that? And he answers his own question. He says, the hunter-gatherer does this, the person in the state of nature does this, because it makes sense for economic reasons, for security reasons. You know, there might be times when it might be good to put on an animal skin and run off into what are the central mountains in Puerto Rico? I forgot what they call it. I pass them over here on the way from San Juan. You could, what's that? Cordillera, yes, you could run up in there, perhaps with a spear and some animal skins. But, you know, in today's parlance, we don't say that a political system or we don't say an individual who comes into society and gives some of their sovereignty to the police, let's say, with respect to the exercise of violence, or gives some of their powers economically to others. We don't call this partial independence. We call this being civilized. And so part of the deal with Puerto Rico, I would argue it's part of being civilized in some ways. Now, it is true that in other partially independent territories, one of the beauties of the arrangement is that it can be changed by contacting the core state and negotiating over time. So, for example, the Åland Islands vis-a-vis Finland, a very sleepy, extremely wealthy place, has revised its arrangement many, many times and continuously tailor-made that arrangement. But sadly, Puerto Rico is gripped by this fight between the pro-statehood and the pro-Commonwealth Party that has so sadly, according to what I can see, prevented Puerto Rico being united. It was so heartening for me to see at this congressional hearing that I was talking about, the one in June of 2015, where at one moment during the hearing, suddenly the pro-Commonwealth leaders and pro-statehood leaders started to agree with one another. I was watching this on YouTube. I remember pausing it. I couldn't believe it. I had to rewind. Did I hear that correctly? Are they really agreeing on something? They were agreeing on the bankruptcy rule. When you look at the Vieques issue, they were again united. Even the independence, pro-independence people were on board with getting America's military out. Everyone was, and the alliance became wider. Puerto Rico has natural allies in America with the larger Hispanic American community, the Cuban American community, and it became irresistible. So I think that, yes, the Jones Act is an awful weight on the backs of Puerto Ricans. It's terrible, and it's something that really should be adjusted. If the Puerto Ricans put the same amount of energy into eradicating or modifying the Jones Act that they did with Vieques, I think the Jones Act would be adjusted.
It's a good point. That will take me to the final part of the question. Do you think that under this partially independent status that we are talking here, we can change all those limitations and turn them into more self-powers to our benefit? Because even important leaders of the Democratic Popular Party and even the statehood leaders, they're asking for, saying that we need all this power, these tools to get out the crisis. Do you think under this status we can change these things and turn it into more self-powers? We need to prove it, right? We need to try it.
All I can say, you know, I'm just one person, one scholar, I wrote a book. All I can say is when I look at other partially independent territories throughout the world, you know, the statehood party, they have the poetry of Puerto Rico turning into Massachusetts, the poetry of Puerto Rico turning into New York or California. But I also have some poetry. I also have some poetry that I introduce in this talk, telling all of you. Puerto Rico could be like Bermuda. Puerto Rico could be like Cayman Islands. Puerto Rico could be like many of these other partially independent territories throughout the world. The potential is there. The potential is there. It's just a matter of having the political will to achieve it. But if the political will isn't there, then, you know, I might grow old, get more gray hair and come here as a very old man. Maybe I would come back to the foundation and give another talk, and still the statehood and Commonwealth Party are at odds with another. It's a matter of political will.
Yeah, no, thank you. I have some short questions. I will only tell you some of them from the students. One of them says, how do we reconcile written law with unwritten law?
Reconciling written law with unwritten law. Well, that's similar to the question that was raised before, but I would just say that Puerto Rico is already entrenched. In my humble view, there's no need to reconcile it. It's as if, I don't know if I can think of another analogy, but Puerto Rico already has the status of sovereignty. The Supreme Court said so in 1982. You have federal appellate courts saying this. You have the history of long history of non-interference. You know, people in the President's Commission, they could say what they're going to say, and people could say that it's a colony. But, you know, it's like, it's as if you have a lion and a dog, right? And it's like you have a lion, and someone says, it's not a lion, it's a dog. It doesn't change the fact that it is not a dog, it's a lion. You could say, someone can say whatever they want to say, but the facts are the facts. The years of non-interference as precedent, the exchange of letters at the outset between the leaders of Puerto Rico and the United States, the statements of the Supreme Court and other appellate courts, there is a way to change that. If the Supreme Court says, actually, you remember that dicta statement we said in 1982 where we said that Puerto Rico is sovereign like a state? Actually, it's not. It's not sovereign. That would make me raise my eyebrows. Mm-hmm. If tomorrow the United States starts interfering in the powers that are outside the bounds of the 1952 arrangement, again, I would say, whoa, that's very interesting. That is a major departure, but we don't see that.
Only a last question, just to make my friends happy. One of them says, do you think that Puerto Rico's constitution provides the mechanisms to deal and solve Puerto Rico's economic crisis?
Say again?
It says, do you think that Puerto Rican's constitution, the actual constitution, provide the mechanisms to deal and solve Puerto Rico's economic crisis?
Well, right now, the Jones Act, this is not a Puerto Rican, this is not in the Puerto Rican constitution. This is a federal law. The federal minimum wage is not in the Puerto Rican constitution, it's a federal law. So these aren't things that are in Puerto Rican's purview. But having said that, I was looking at, you were mentioning the GAO report. Actually, I know the GAO report would be a departure from your question right now, but the Puerto Ricans have a lot of potential, a lot of power in the United States. There are three or four different members of Congress that are Puerto Rican that are in the mainland. You have a Supreme Court justice who's Puerto Rican. You know, that is amazing degrees of power. You have a large section of America's electorate that is growing and that is feared by both the Democrats and the Republicans, especially when a new presidential election occurs. The Puerto Ricans are bristling with powers vis-a-vis the United States. That's not the issue. The issue is to simply have the political will to unite on a particular issue, and maybe, hopefully the bankruptcy issue and the Jones Act will be similar to Vieques. If it is, I wouldn't be surprised that Puerto Rico eventually has its way. You know, from the date that the security worker on Vieques was killed by the stray bomb, it happened in 1999, to the date where George Bush signed the statement to get the military out of Vieques in 2003. So that's 3 or 4 years. So if we start the clock ticking on the bankruptcy issue, I don't know, in 2015, or maybe let's just be generous and say 2014. So Puerto Rico, if it's going to match its feet with Vieques, it still has like two or three more years to solve the bankruptcy issue, to solve the Jones Act, to match the Vieques, and so we'll see.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Rezvani, for your talk. Thank you all. Buenas noches a todos. Muchísimas gracias por su presencia aquí. Vamos a pasar ahora al segundo piso, donde vamos a poder disfrutar de unos canapés y poder compartir ya de uno a uno entre nosotros y con el Dr. Rezvani. Buenas noches y muchas gracias por apoyarnos en la Fundación Biblioteca Rafael Hernández Colón.